In this first slide, you see. In this first slide, you see, in a nutshell, the part of the problem discussed by Yakir Levin in the previous lecture. You look at this wolf, and everyone can directly see that this is a threatful situation, and that the wolf is showing what they call active submission. You see that he's twisted, he's bristled, his tail is between his legs, and he's low on his hind legs, and also low on his bit low on his forelegs, but less so. And you can see that his back is slanted upwards, and his head is coming down. But the first thing that comes to, we grasp immediately, and even a child would grasp, is this aspect of meaning of active submission. And to see the structure, to look at the geometry or at the structure of this behavior, involves investment. And structure and function go together all the way, and they are inseparable in biology. This is what biology is about, structure and function. And it so happens that structure is more conservative than function. And in my approach, I don't deny function, because function cannot be denied. It's the essence of biology. Survival is a function, and it cannot be denied. All I am advocating is suspension and of judgment about function. It pays to suspend judgment, because function is enchanting us, and then we don't see anything else. So what I suggest is first look at structure, and of course, then we can attend to function. That's all. My first encounter with biology as a soldier, I came to a meeting of the Nature Protection, and my future supervisor, Professor Heinrich Mendelssohn, was supposed to give a lecture about behavior, and he had a very serious flu, couldn't give the lecture, so he took us to the zoo, opened the door between two cages, and there were jackals and wolves, and they got mixed up, and there was a big, what they call, later I understood they called, ritualized fighting behavior. And this impressed me so much that 2 years later, after finishing the army, I came to study biology. And I want to show you this movie now. A similar movie was taken in Canada in semi-wild conditions by a collaborator, Greg Moran. And please, when you look at it, try, I mean, meaning and function will reach you immediately. You will see a martial art situation between two wolves. But please pay attention. One is relatively free. This is called the superior wolf. And the other is as if paralyzed. He's heavily constrained. And I want you to be impressed with this phenomenon. What is this constraint? Share it again. You can see the one closer to us is a plantigrade on his whole feet. He's partly paralyzed in the hind quarters. You see, squatting on his hind quarters, walking with a curved body, and shifting all the time from forward progression to pivoting. and to squatting, and to a particular relation between snout and cheek, which is steadily maintained for some time. It's a kind of a blocking technique. But you see one constrained and one free wolf. And this impressed me very much. What is it? What is this constraint? What does it mean to be free, if you want? And what does it mean to be constrained? What are the constraints on the behavior? I didn't frame it in these words, but this intuitively impressed the hell out of me. And this is what I studied. You see, he's walking, and as soon as another wolf is approaching him, you'll see the transition from forward locomotion to pivoting and to squatting. This is a semi-wild situation. You see, he's crouched. So, 2 years later, I came to study in the university, and immediately I looked up the literature about this phenomenon. And what I found, please remind me if I forget, don't hesitate. You see on the left, all the literature was in German, and you see, aktive Unterwerfung, active submission. Passive, down on the left, passive Unterwerfung, passive submission. And so on and so forth. You see, one animal, two animals, one is walking freely, the other is completely twisted and constrained. So, naively, I thought, I read that they were called behavior patterns, and I read that the behavior of wolf in German is, I remember the word, variationgebunden, meaning it's variable. So what is it all about? What does it mean, variable? And what does it mean, invariable? And why do they call it a behavior pattern? So the obvious thing to do is to figure out what a behavior pattern is. So the next thing I filmed jackals in an interactions. It was done with a celluloid. There was no video. And I had a moviola, like in the old days, that you turn it and look inside. And we scratched with a pin every second number. And we tried to code the behavior. And at the bottom, you see a profile of 24 numbers, which code the behavior at a certain moment. Every item has a meaning. So let's say the first one is tail up, and it has several numerals, and the second is parallel to the other animal, or orthogonal, or face to face, and there is an item for a facet for bristling, and so on and so forth. And I get the behavior of the two wolves described in terms of a profile of 24 numerals that code the behavior. And I went to the expert at the time, a famous sociologist and mathematician, Louis Gutmann, and I did my PhD in a method called multidimensional scalogram analysis, trying to look for clusters to see repetitions in order to prove that there are clusters in the behavior. And I had such 2,000 clusters, and only 30 of them returned more than once. In other words, coding this behavior fragmented it irrevocably. And I had these multidimensional scalogram presentations where you have a multidimensional table where every point represents a configuration of numbers. And I looked at continuity and contiguity between groups of these profiles. So in the next one, you see, for instance, bristling. The field is divided into high bristling and low bristling and so on. And this is of the male. And I put on top of it, it's a kind of a multidimensional table. Details are not important now. But I put them one on the other, and I didn't find anything. This was my PhD. And I had a problem. So I came somehow out of the problem. But the phenomena are the recurrence of a particular configuration is extremely rare. The labeling is ad hoc of movement patterns, and it yields immensely heterogeneous configuration. The ad hoc building blocks are not natural kinds. They are off the top from my sleeve. I intuitively divide the behavior into units, reasonable units, like tail up, tail horizontal, tail down, tail between the legs, ears forward, ears sideways, and so on. And I don't get anything. Another point is that this coding is not generalizable. If it, had it been good, it would be good for the jackals, but it cannot use for anything else. And this Bar Hillel, the philosopher, called the fallacy of the first step, meaning that climbing a tree is not the first step to the moon. So I learned from it that any coding or any symbolizing of the behavior, I should have a perspective for generalizability. Because if I am a zoologist, and the essence of zoology is comparative studies, so I need a method that will be generalizable to as many species as possible. Otherwise, I get stuck from the beginning. Most important, the categories are poor vehicles of thought and perception of movement. Creating categories or making a code or a shorthand is not creating vehicles of thought. If you want to study movement, you need tools to perceive and to think about movement. And Eddington, in a book, Introduction to Mathematics, says that the difference between the Roman numerals and the Arabic numerals is such that a third-year grade student can calculate any number you want, whereas a Greek philosopher, using the Greek notation of numerals, could not calculate anything. So notation is a tool for thinking, for putting your thoughts on the paper, seeing your thoughts, and clearing your head for new thoughts. And this is the meaning of a notation. It's embodying your thoughts on paper and then communicating with these thoughts and bringing up new thoughts. So this failure taught me that I need a different way to describe the behavior. And then what to do? Now I was a zoologist, and Konrad Lorenz, in his Nobel Prize lecture, said that the main achievement of ethology is the discovery, is the understanding, the insight that behavior is an extension of anatomy, and that homologies can be described in behavior as much as in anatomy. But it was a double message, because when he did his PhD, he didn't apply this insight, And he came up either with ad hoc definitions, like I with the jackals, or with theory-loaded labels like active submission, passive submission, inferiority, superiority, and so on. It's not a language for anatomy. So it was a double message, and indeed etology got stuck because they did not, or we did not, have a language to think about movement like anatomists think about anatomy. And it took time to understand, to really understand, what the implications of Lawrence's statement was. And you see this, you already saw this figure by Akir, but it gives the essence of the whole thing, that when you compare two animals in anatomy, it is clear that the primitives are the bones. And the bones are assembled into modules, which we call organs. There is a module of a head, a module of a right hand, left leg, organized in modules. And also there are generative rules. We all studied embryology. We know that morphogenesis starts with a single cell into a cluster of cells, a morula, which becomes a blastula, and then to gastrula, and so on and so forth, and you get ultimately an organism with three histological layers and so on. So if I want to take Lawrence seriously and to do behavior as you do comparative morphology, my question is, what are the bones in behavior? What are the primitives? What are the modules? And what are the generative rules? Here you see the body plan of vertebrates and arthropods. And you see that the trunk is partitioned. It's a bow plan. It's an architectural plan. And this is one of the hallmarks of evolutionary biology, that they find the toolkit genes that regulate the production or the unfoldment of this kind of body plan, which consists of segments, parts partitioned into specialized grouping of modules along the antero-posterior axis, both in the vertebrates and in the arthropods. So this is the body plan. And if we want behavior to be an extension of anatomy, then we need a description that will emerge out of this body plan, which reflect this body plan. And this is what the Eshkol-Wachmann movement notation is. This is what it does. It reflects anatomy. Now, what is anatomy for, asks a famous anatomist in the early previous century. Anatomy is for behavior. So we have to take anatomy to determine for us what the units of behavior are. Now, Eshkol-Wachmann movement notation has a way to describe the movements of the whole linkage, while also specifying the contribution of each of the segments to the movements of that linkage. Yeah, you remember that, I don't know if you remember, but once there were those meters made of plywood that were connected by joints. So you have a series of serially connected rigid segments. And it's there's too much freedom of movement if you hold the first one, and now you want to do things with this articulated linkage, there's hardly anything you can, nothing you can do because of the abundance of degrees of freedom. And this is a phenomenon described by a Jewish Russian neurophysiologist, Nicholas Bernstein, which is the problem of overdetermination of degrees of freedom, redundancy of degrees of freedom. So this, as you saw the body plan, how can you control such a body plan? You need constraints. You need to lock the joints between the segments to be able to do anything. And Eshkol-Wachmann offers a way to handle this linkage. And the way is, as was mentioned, is the heavy and light limbs hierarchy, that you have, first of all, to establish the points of support. And movement, a single movement, and you have a heavy limb, the one which is in contact, and then the serially connected limbs. And if a light limb moves, it doesn't change the orientation of any of the other limbs. If one next to the lightest moves, he moves also the one that is lighter than him, and so on until the base of the linkage, which when it moves the whole linkage. So we have this idea of a linkage of rigidly connected segments, and the movement, a single movement, in no method do you have a clear-cut definition of what a simple movement is. 21st century, and in all the studies of movement, you don't have a definition of what a simple movement is. And in Eshkol-Wachmann movement notation, a simple movement is a change of relation between a light limb and its next adjacent neighbor, heavier neighbor. And this is expressed by a notational complex or expression, by a notational expression. So we have a single movement, and we have the heavy and light limbs principle, and this allows us to describe the whole linkage. So the next step, and before that, how are the primitives and the modules of the body plan reflected in the behavioral Bauplan? What are the generative rules that shape behavior? As in anatomy, so in behavior, morphogenesis is the key for understanding structure. It's the only way to understand structure, to see how it grows and differentiates. And for studying morphogenesis, it is necessary to use a natural origin, an origin used by the animal, and then start from there to measure behavior. Adaptive and functional descriptions often obscure the morphogenetic rules shaping behavior. And this is another tool that I use, and I hope I have time to show you, is the use of monsters. I was not aware of a very old, 300 years and more, tradition of studying monsters in biology. But by giving an animal a drug or performing a lesion, you create a caricature of the real animal, and in fact, you could call it a monster. What characterizes this monster is that its behavior is not adaptive, but it highlights and exaggerates the generative rules of behavior. And this has been done since 18,000. There are heavy volumes of monsters demonstrating the morphogenetic rules. And it's one of the hallmarks of Evo Devo also, the use of monsters. And it's this whole controversy, 300 years controversy in biology between adaptationists and internalists. That the internalist, the adaptationists explain everything by natural selection and adaptation. The internalists say there are also intrinsic rules, constraints of the material, of the very material, and evolution itself. And one way to study these constraints is to take a monster. Because what is the idea? I mean, if you have homologies, they are invariants, and you cannot destroy them. This is the essence of the organism. So if anything is left, is the generative rules. And the monsters highlights these generative rules. So part of the methodology I used, not being aware that it was such a long tradition in anatomy, but at the same time, it was also discovered by Per Alberch, a Spaniard from Barcelona, who described these monsters, showing that the rules of morphogenesis are most evident in these monsters. So I remind you, we are looking for primitives, modules, generative rules, and the monsters demonstrate them in the most pure way. So what was left for me is the movement notation, and this was the quantal jump that I did in my career, giving away the coding that I used before and moving into movement notation, describing the segments of the body and their movement within spherical frames of reference, individual frame for each segment. The horizontal planes describe the individual spheres for each segment, which are parallel at all times to the general frame of reference on the right. And on the left, you see the heavy and light limbs hierarchy. On the leftmost jackal, who rears on his hind legs, we start from the hind feet, and we see the metatarsus directed up, and the lower leg, and then the upper leg, and then the trunk. But the same jackal, when he shifts weight to his four legs, he's leaning on his forelegs, and we describe the foreleg, the metacarpal, in relation to the foot, and the lower arm in relation to the lower leg, and so on, and the trunk. So the idea is that this linkage is always anchored on reality. This is the way physics, we are studying structure, but we sneak in physics by looking at the point of support. And in this way, we put in the mechanical interdependence between the limbs. And from that point, we use tools that describe the interconnectedness of the linkage, always in reference to the environment, in relevance to the environment. How am I in time? So here, just to give you a glimpse of the power of the Eshkol-Wachmann movement notation. One of the powers is that, you see, if I perform, I'm performing now this movement. And there is absolutely no clear cognitive way to describe the end. This is, the upper arm is heavy, the lower arm is lighter, and the hand is lightest. And I perform this movement. And if I want to describe mathematically the trajectory that the tip of my hand performed, I cannot do it. But if I describe the building blocks of this process, what I did two simple movements. One simple movement is moving my hand from this position to this position, 90 degrees in the horizontal plane. Another simple movement is moving my upper arm 90 degrees in relation to my upper arm or to the elbow. So these are two simple movements, and I can describe them cognitively. The whole business is a cognitive representation. I didn't say it, but the whole idea of the movement notation is that we will have tools for thinking, meaning a cognitive representation. And it has to conform or to correspond to the body. So if you find now very sophisticated descriptions of worms moving in terms of eigenvectors and sinusoids, the problem is that it is almost impossible to visualize and think about the combination of eigenvectors. It is not generalizable. So you cannot do a comparative study. So here, this is completely cognitive and visualizable. The upper arm movement and the lower arm movement and the combination. And the outcome is not. I don't know. I cannot formulate cognitively what I did with the tip of my hand. So this is very essential to understand what the Eshkol-Wachmann movement notation has a way of describing what the ingredients do. But when there is simultaneous movement, we don't always know what happened at the tip of this linkage. But the main thing is that we got a cognitive way of thinking about movement, and this is good for jackals, for men, for infant, for a worm if it's relatively rigid, and of course for arthropods who have rigid segments. So whatever I find, I can generalize and compare across the animal kingdom, which is elementary for a zoologist. And here, just to give you a taste, at the bottom you see a single movement, and on top of it you see cords of movement. And when I looked at the jackal courtship, what I found, that they combine the simple movements of single segments into cords of movement, maintaining certain invariant positions. Relatively simple things, like when a jackal turns his neck in a certain direction, then the body joins in the same direction. So you have a movement of the neck, and then two antagonistic movements of the neck and the body, and going in that direction. So this is a chord, I called it a root of convergence, meaning that there is an attractor and there is a transient leading to the maintenance of this attractor. And in the jackal display, I found five such roots of convergence of the individual animal, which are locomotor patterns, and two interactional invariants. When the two jackals move together, they establish a certain relationship of opposition, and they maintain this opposition, and they twist each other through this joint, common joint between them, and they move like a superorganism. And what I found, the jackals come and they do all kinds of funny things, like what you saw in the beginning of the film. They twist and they run around each other, and one lies on the ground and topples and makes a saltation in the air. But it is all based on, they give priority to the maintenance of the special joint between them, which can be from a distance, and on several locomotor invariants. This was the paper on homeostatic motor patterns. And in another study, I found, which was done with Yona Yaniv, who is with us here. This was her master's degree. And this is a study on honey badgers. And I bring it because you can see in a nutshell the whole material of the analysis of movement of the honey badger. You can see all the decisions. Everything is transparent and explicit. First of all, we look at the upper badger at the top. Since he's pivoting on his hind legs, the hind legs are the heavy part. So when they move, when the badger moves the pelvis, it moves also the chest. And when it moves the chest, it moves also the neck and the head. And when it pivots the whole body. So here, you both have the elementary movements of the badger, but you can also combine them to whole body rotation. And in the second from top, you see the three rotations around which the badger rotates. So you see the vertical axis on the hind legs, the vertical axis on the forelegs, so the animal can pivot on the hind legs, pivot on the forelegs. It can log roll the longitudinal axis of the body, and it can saltate. This is the side-to-side axis, and it can tumble head-on, or it can tumble pelvis-on. So I can describe both the individual movements of the badger and whole body rotations around the axis. And in addition, I put the coordinates on the surface of the body of the badger, so when the two badgers interact, I can describe the relationship of opposition and contact between them. And what Yona discovered was that there were two relations of opposition that were stable. Once they were reached between the two animals, they were maintained. And as a result of this, one animal can flip the other animal in the air because they give priority to maintaining this relationship. In Hebrew, הם הולכים בלהוריד אחד את השני דרך המפרק ממרחק. אחד עושה הורדה לשני because they have this priority of maintaining the joint. One can twist and turn around and shift the other animal, and all the while they maintain all the other locomotor invariances. And the display is just locomoting in the proximity of a partner. Here you see the on the left top, you see pivoting around the hind legs. On the left middle, you see pivoting around the forelegs. On the right, you can see tumbling head-on around the side-to-side axis. And on the bottom, you see two lines of rolling, log rolling, around the longitudinal axis of the body. So we had both roots of we had simple movements, and they combined two chords of whole body movements, and we could find the syntax between them. And here you see an interaction between two badgers, and let's just take the bottom two rows. You see the female comes, she touches the male in the hindquarters. Sorry, the male comes and touches the female in the hindquarters. And the female always responds in one way. She pivots around her hind legs to establish snout-to-cheek contact with the other animal, and you see that she is constrained. Her hind legs are paralyzed. And I, as a zoologist, I look for constraints because the constraints shape the behavior. So here you see the constraints. You see that there is an animal which is not free. Once it is touched in the hindquarters, it responds in a completely stereotypic way, turning forward walking to pivoting, squatting. The other animal is free. If it's touched in the hind legs, you don't know what it will do. It can do anything. It can tumble head on, cannot respond at all. It can pivot one way or the other. So we get one free animal and one constrained animal. And this is the difference between what people call inferiority and superiority. So you see that I describe here stress. Implicitly, I describe here stress in terms of degrees of freedom of movement. Stress emerges without necessarily mentioning it, because you see a constrained animal, and the constraint is the rule is progression from forward to pivoting to squatting to immobility. But this is the adult phenomenon. And I learned that if you want to understand adult organization, you need ontogeny. The same that if you want to understand the human body, you need embryology. Otherwise, you don't understand it. When you see the finished product, you cannot get a clue about organization. You need morphogenesis to understand organization. So this is how I moved to the study of morphogenesis. I will skip it. And now I go to morphogenesis. And this is how we came to study ontogeny. This is a study done with David Elam, who is here. And this he did in notation, that we take an infant mouse, we drop it in a stressful new environment, we pluck it out of its home, it freezes, it has to freeze for long enough time, and now you see the mobility gradient, the transition from immobility, and it is cephalocaudal, you see, that the animal is locked, and the first thing to move is the head, and then the neck, and then the chest, the feel. And gradually, the whole body is recruited from head to tail in pivoting. And only after pivoting is exhausted does it walk forward. And only after walking forward, it raises her head. This is the fundamental transition from immobility. And this description is based on the body plan of the animal and on the heavy and light limbs hierarchy. Without it, you don't see it. I didn't see it. But because of the heavy and light limb, I know that the head is moving on the chest. I don't talk in terms of flexions and extensions, which are detached from the environment. So it always contextual and anchored to the environment. Nigmar? And here you see the rule. So you see three modules. On top you see the initial position, the immobility. But second line from top, you see we start from left. First of all, the head moves. We go on along the column, then the chest moves, and then the pelvis moves, and you get pivoting around the hind legs. The pelvis will not move unless the chest moved in the horizontal. The head will not move in the horizontal unless... Sorry, someone is ringing. The end of my Schlafstunde. נחבר אותו.
כן, אני אחבר אותו. תראי לה, תן לי את זה. תמשיך לדבר.
The second row is the second module. Forward progression. Head first, chest next, pelvis next. The third one is the vertical on the hind legs. And the rule is you cannot move a part of the body unless the part of the body cephalad already moved. And you cannot move along a dimension unless you already moved along the previous dimension in the gradient. And this is the mobility gradient. It is a homology because it is not based on similarity. It is based on relative topological position. This is the definition of homology, occupying the same position in a network. So this is according to the anatomical pre-Darwinian definition of a homology. The explanation to this is seen here in an axolotl, in a description from 1929. On the left top, you see the immobility, and then you see start of movement in the horizontal domain, and it proceeds along the whole body. And when two such horizontal movements are performed out of phase one after the other, you get forward progression. So you see this in an axolotl. And you see this also in an adult animal, here a hedgehog. When an adult hedgehog is placed in a stressful environment, it immobilizes, then gains support of the forelegs, then starts to move cephalocaudally, exhausting the whole horizontal movement, and only then proceeding forward. And I could show it to you, one animal after the other. I'll spare it to you. You'll have to believe me. This is, in adults, the transition out of immobility. Next. Next. I do next. אני לא רואה את זה. אני לא אראה אותם. Now we come to the behavioral monsters. And here you see the recovery, neurological recovery of an animal out of a lesion, following a lesion with dopamine deficiency in the brain. And you can see what you saw in ontogeny. You see exactly the same in recovery, but it's like a caricature. It's a highlighting that the body, the whole body is inhibited from movement, so the lightest limb moves in an exaggerated way before recruiting the next limb. So, again, the advantages of a monster, adaptation does not explain the form. The deformation highlights the invariance. We focus on the invariance, not on the diversity. And it demonstrates how much of the form is produced by internal factors not by the environment, because it's not adaptational. And teratologies always are generated, they have the same form, very few. It's not a continuous phenotypic space, it's islands of specific kinds of deformities that repeat with different treatments. It's one of the characteristics of Evo-Devo and also of anatomical monsters. For instance, anatomical embryos have a bifurcation, they have two heads. You never have a monster, a baby, with three heads, unless it was a bifurcation into two heads, and then one head bifurcated into two. So this is the morphogenetic rule. And so on. I will spare you more examples because we don't have time. So here you see recovery exactly like in ontogeny. First of all, exhaustion, cephalocaudal exhaustion of the horizontal. Then cephalocaudal, see here the straitjacket phenomenon. You see the head moves exaggeratedly before the chest joins. Then when the chest moves, the pelvis doesn't move. When the pelvis moves, you see the two hind legs, they stay rooted in an amazing way before they join. So you see this cephalocaudal recruitment in a very exaggerated way, highlighting the generative principle. The same then forward progression and then vertical movement. So I hope you already see that by going, like Freud, by going into ontogeny, into regression, you understand adult behavior. What you see in the inferior wolf is regression and coming out in the opposite way to the way the limbs come in. Here you see the opposite way in which limbs drop out of action. So on top you see, this is with the dopamine agonist, you see the shutdown. The rat walks forward, then the path becomes curved, increasingly more curved, and then it becomes completely tight, and then his hind legs squat and he becomes almost immobilized on the ground. And here you can see the movie. You see the shutdown, a regression process. And you see the rules in pure form. So this is still normal. The drug didn't take effect yet. Warm up. This is normal warm up. Pivoting, going forward. Now the drug took effect, no more rearing, eliminated rearing, forward progression, unless by corners or walls, and now curved paths come in. He's regressing into immobility through squatting. So you see in life the generative principle of shutdown. I'll spare you examples from life, but everyone who has a dog knows how a dog goes to sleep or to defecate. So he's moving into immobility and he's going from forward progression to going in circles to pivoting, squatting, and immobility or sleep. So this is the homology. Let's go next. And you see the same thing in a fruit fly. A fruit fly is waking up from cocaine. He sniffed cocaine, became immobile, and now he comes out of the cocaine. Please go. Starts from pivoting. So what I described to you is the Bauplan of behavior. And you see that it is common to flies, to vertebrates, to arthropods, to vertebrates. And we have seen it also in a human infant. We don't know yet to interpret it, but this phenomenon is also found in some way which we do not understand yet in human infants. You see the transition from pivoting to curved path and to forward locomotion. And the next one, the opposite, he's free, he's sniffing cocaine, and you see the transition into immobility. And so you see that I study all this behavior using the same tools in order so I can do comparative study and study this homology of transition in and out of immobility. נגמר לי הזמן? Here you see this phenomenon treated graphically. On the left, on the top, you see the behavior. Look how complex, absolutely, I mean, it's like the movie that Yair showed in his, the beginning of his talk. And here you see at the beginning what a fly does. He's in an arena, and then in the middle, cocaine is pumped into the arena, and he goes into immobility. So you see the point, there is a red point that shows the place of immobility. So it's transition into immobility and out of immobility. And in B, you see it stretched out in time, so you can see before immobility and after immobility. So the natural reference point to examine this behavior is the immobility. This is the origin. So we use it to measure the behavior. And in the last two, you can see all the flies, and you can see how the space they explore shrinks gradually in time for all the flies, and how it expands after immobility, which is the reference in the last one, in F. You see for all the flies how their explored space extends. So we are talking of attention, the span of attention, and how it narrows down, and how it widens up in a fruit fly. And here, immobility, the middle rectangle, describes immobility. So you see how we handle the whole complexity of the behavior. This is a reference, and you see the events leading to it and leading out. So on top, you see velocity. And you see that the first thing is going straight. And then at the bottom, you see the rotation. And you see that it becomes more intense, closer to immobility. And in the transition out of immobility, you see the pivoting at the bottom, very intense, and becomes slower. And at the top, you see that forward movement, speed, translation, becomes high later. And you can also see the curvature of the path. So there are 3 degrees of freedom, and in the fly and in the rat, they are the same. It's quite striking that you have the same homology in fruit flies and in mammals. And this is a graph devised by Yoav, who translated it into quantitative terms. I will not go now, it's very difficult for me to see from here, but maybe you can show with the peaks, the relation between the peaks. So before immobility, let's look at B. So before immobility, translation is high, the peak of translation higher, and rotation is low. And then rotation is high next, before immobility, as translation is low. And after immobility, after the dark stripe, the opposite occurs. And in C, we look at these relations, so we define invariance across flies that show enormously variable behavior. We show the generative rules of transition from forward progression to pivoting to immobility to pivoting to forward progression. So in summary, I will have to stand up to be able to read what's written here. So what did we have? We got primitives. These are single movements of a light path in reference to its next heavier neighbor. We define a simple movement, a movement that can be symbolized by one notational expression per movement. We have modules. The modules are chords of movements, 5 roots of convergence in the jackals, 2 interactional roots, 6 spatial dimensions, what I showed in recovery and in ontogeny. I did not go into detail to show that there are really 6. I showed you at least 3. Whole body rotations. Then we got a generative rule for build-up. Following immobility, do not recruit a path in movement unless you already recruited it in the previously specified dimension, and unless you recruited the path anterior to it along that dimension. Fixed order of emergence of 6 dimensions. And during narrowing down, last in, first out. We unify anatomy, the body plan, and behavior into 1 Bauplan. We unify moment to moment, developmental, phylogenetic. I didn't go into it, but there is a study of David Elam showing that the same rules, he reviews phylogenetic data showing that the warm-up applies also at the level of phylogenesis, like the transition from horizontal movement in primitive animals to vertical movement in more differentiated animals. And they all combine into 1 Bauplan. We suggest that vertebrates and arthropods share the same locomotor Bauplan. Now, a sequel to this talk on movement in locale space has been presented in a symposium in honor of Professor Yoav Binyamini. It should appear soon on the web, in which we try to show the existence of, to demonstrate the existence of homologies at the level of locale space. The next one. Now, I did not talk about it, but implicitly, the six spatial modules imply successive distinct sensory and perceptual input. Horizontal movement implies tactile movement and olfactory. Rearing implies visual information, procession of visual information. The modular perception implies a hierarchy of attention and a systematic order of inaction of space. The animal enacts space every time it starts to move, dimension by dimension, in a modular way. However primordial, systematic inaction of space implies cognition. Apropos Yakir's lecture, cognition is implied by building one dimension after the other. The Bauplan consists of a hierarchy of anatomy, perception, attention, emotion, and cognition of real space. And these are all the wonderful people who collaborated in these studies. Thank you very much.